Hey, welcome from Israel, and we are really thankful to Charlie Kirk and TP USA Faith for allowing us to come and be here and also subsidizing this trip and making it possible. Just a real blessing, real gift. We're here with about 25 other pastors from around the U.S., Nevada, California, Arizona, Montana, I think Washington, a number of different states. But we had a little bit of a scare when I flew down to L.A. My blood oxygen levels dropped pretty severe, and right as we took off, we made some calls to the doctors, but right when we took off to leave for Israel, my lung doctor called and said, he may have a blood clot, he shouldn't go. Well, it was a little too late.
We were on the runway.
Yeah. Literally. So Christy did not have the best flight.
No.
She was a little worried.
I didn't sleep. We are, it is Israel nighttime and American daytime, and we have not slept. So yeah. We are looking forward to rest and then be rejuvenated for tomorrow for the adventures ahead.
Before we head home, my blood oxygen levels seem to do okay. Not great, but do okay when I'm here, like just on the ground. They kind of fluctuate. I have oxygen, so it helps. But when I get in the plane, they've decided to go crazy. That's why they think I have a blood clot. So I'm going to get some x-rays.
Before we leave Israel, we're going to go to the ER and get that checked out before we make a flight home, because I don't want to do a flight like that on the way home.
So we appreciate all of you. Let you know that our prayers are with you. We appreciate your prayers being with us. We are expecting a incredible time, and should be a great time of learning and growing, and hopefully
building relationships.
Yeah, building some great relationship with some other pastors who've already met, like 8 different couples that were just really awesome people from around the U.S. of some great churches. Again, thanks to Charlie Kirk. He did not end up making it on this trip. He had planned on it and was not able to, but he sent some great people. Yeah. So, all right.
We love you. God bless you. And we will see you when we get home.
Thanks.
Well, thank you for joining us. My name is Pastor Monte. It is my privilege today, as Pastor Aaron and Pastor Christy are away in Israel, to be able to share a message with us entitled The Keys to Endurance. And there are many challenges that we face in life that will hold us back, that will try to keep us from finishing the race. But just like the Apostle Paul encouraged us, I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. And the keys to endurance, we're going to be looking at some verses in Hebrews, and I believe it'll be a blessing to you today. We're going to be in the book of Hebrews for a little bit, and mainly, let me just get it here. Hebrews, most of the time in Hebrews chapter 10, but it's important to lay just a little bit of a foundation first before we get to that. It's going to all be kind of in Hebrews. And I want to talk about endurance, and I want to give us some specific keys from the scripture to endurance. And I'm just going to tell you what they are. In Hebrews chapter 10, I'm going to read these verse 19 through 25 is what I'm going to do right now. And do you guys like to have fun?
Yes.
All right. So this is going to be fun for me. I don't know if it'll be fun for you. But there's three keys from Hebrews chapter 10 to endurance. You know, the Bible says to him who overcomes. Every letter to the 7 churches in Revelation, God gives an encouragement, and then he gives an instruction. Okay, this is what you're doing good. Here's where you're blowing it. Stop blowing it. And to him who overcomes. So we've got to overcome, amen? We cannot become weary in well-doing, as Galatians says. We have to have a mindset that we are going to finish. We're going to run the race. We are not going to quit. We are not going to give up. I am not going to lose my faith. I'm not going to allow any lie or any person or any demon to bump me off track of what God has called me to do and what he has for me. Amen? So I'm going to give you three keys to help us do that. They're in this verse. So, therefore, verse 19 of Hebrews 10, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his body, his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Verse 23. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Verse 24. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as we see the day, capital D, see the day approaching. So here's the message today. Let us draw near, let us hold fast, and let us consider one another. All right? So what I'd like for us to do is, every time I say, let us, and pause, I want you to clap once. So it's going to be, I'll show you. It's going to be like this. Let us, okay, so let's try it together. Let us draw near to God. Let us hold fast our confession. And let us consider one another. All right? Think you can manage that? It's a lot of responsibility. And we want everybody to participate. You know, I don't have time to get it. There's actually power. You know, when we're worshiping and singing and we're clapping our hands, there's actually power in that. There's power in that. And there's power in the corporateness of it. There's power individually. And it is, you know what it is? It's a breaking. It's breaking the hindrances, breaking the strongholds, breaking through whatever, doubt, fear, unbelief, whatever it is. That's what that clap, So that's the thing. Now, this passage of scripture talks about drawing near to God by the blood of Jesus, and just here's something for you to think about and maybe look at it later on your own. But the entire book of Hebrews was really written for the benefit of the Jews. Now, it benefits us because there's these three things that I just shared. I mean, there's precious things in here. But the mindset for the Hebrews was writing to the Jewish people, because we have to remember that for thousands of years, they knew and worshiped God a certain way, as God had instructed them. Now we know it as the Old Covenant, but they didn't know it as the Old Covenant. They knew this is how we connect with God, through the sacrifices, through the sprinkling of blood, through all of the things as God instructed them. And then Jesus showed up, and God said, I'm going to do it a better way through a better sacrifice. I'm going to send my Son, my only begotten Son, and he is going to die once for all. So no longer will we have to offer the blood of bulls and of goats and of animals. No longer will we have to sprinkle that, because Jesus. So when it's talking about Jesus as our high priest, that may or may not mean a lot to us, but if we know about the Jewish culture, it's like that was huge. I mean, it was a lot to expect to get your head around. I mean, it would be like if all of a sudden the way we know and worship God is like, okay, well, now we're going to do it this way. You would be a little bit apprehensive, wouldn't you? Yeah. You'd be like, okay, whoa, 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 put the brakes on that for a minute. I'm not used to that. So how many know God can show up any way he wants to show up? Amen. I often thought, if God ever asked me for advice, and he doesn't, because... because he's the great I am, and I'm the great I am not, right? I was like, God, I almost said dude, but I don't think you should call God dude. God, why don't you just show up at halftime of the Super Bowl? Just like right on the 50-yard line, you know? But that would be trouble. You see, the reality is, and the scripture tells us this, you know, remember when the rich man died and he asked, send somebody back to my family and tell them, because he didn't know God. He was just filled with his own life and doing things. And this is what they said. If they don't believe the prophets, if they don't believe the word of God now, they're not going to believe even if someone comes back from the dead. And isn't that the truth? Isn't that the way we are? If we're not going to exercise faith, if we choose to not hear the voice of God, then even though God himself would show up, it probably wouldn't make a difference. And we have the most precious gift, and that is the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is constantly speaking. We just need to dial into his frequency and allow the word of God to come alive in us. So let us draw near to God. First of all, let us, that was very lame. Let us, I'll give you a little more warning next time. Let us draw near. Now, let me tell you, the good news is that for those of you that are here, now I don't know your heart, and I don't know your attitude, I don't know your motivation, but there's a very good possibility that the keys to endurance, thank you, Pastor Anthony, that is awesome. The keys to endurance you are already doing by being here this morning. Because you decided, I'm going to go to church and I am going to draw near to God. That's what we've been doing all morning. We have been drawing near to God. And so the question that I want to ask myself and propose to us is there anything happening that is a hindrance for me drawing near to God? Have I allowed a weight or a sin or fear or anxiety or pride? Is there anything that is stopping the flow of me drawing near to God? Remember, he invited us. What does the book of James say? Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. But James is a pretty blunt dude. I call James a dude. And he also says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. And purify your hearts, you double-minded. In other words, that word actually means that your soul is going two different directions, your mind and your will and your emotions. And let me tell you something, that's a miserable place to be. Being single-minded in the service to God, in the love of God, in the fellowship of God. The two conditions to meet, let us draw near to God, and there's two conditions. Number one, with a true heart or with a sincere heart. Do you know what that means? That means it's not fake. It's not phony. It's not just vain repetition. It's not just something that we do every Sunday or Wednesday or whatever it is. And see, I mean, I can tell just in our time of worship. I mean, you came to meet with God. You came, those of you that are watching, maybe you couldn't be here in person. But you are taking the time and the energy because you are hoping that as we gather together that we are going to draw near to God. And that's where we want to be. But do you know that you can be in an atmosphere of God? You can be in a congregation full or a Bible study or even a stadium filled with believers and yet not participate. Not be included, because our proximity to God may not reflect our heart. Think about this for a moment. Lucifer, the archangel, the covering cherub over the throne of God. Now, he's not Lucifer, the archangel anymore. What's his name now? Satan, the devil. Satan means destroyer. He was in proximity to the throne of God, but yet he allowed pride to fill his heart. So I don't ever want to make the mistake that just because I'm in the right group doesn't mean I'm in. I need to know God personally. I need to draw near to God myself, to hunger and thirst for Him. The second condition, so a true, sincere heart, not fake. And the second is in full assurance or being confident, which is an expression of faith. In other words, that I believe that when I draw near to God, I can actually get there. And the reason I can get there is because we have a high priest who has passed into heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. And He ever lives to make intercession for us. I can actually access another place in Hebrews that says, therefore, come boldly. That's not arrogant. That's faith. Come boldly to the throne of grace that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help in your time of need. He's encouraging us to come. He's invited us to come. Listen, if you are sensing distance in your nearness to God, a couple of things. One, ask God to invite you in. And then if He does, you better buckle up. And another thing, and I pray this, God, give me a hunger. Give me a hunger for Your word. Give me a hunger for Your presence. Because I'm just like you. It's real easy to just go day after day living life and never pressed in, never had that hunger to say, you know what? I want to draw near to God. Fanny Crosby has written a number of great hymns of the church, Blessed Assurance, and she wrote literally hundreds of songs. She was blind as a child from a difficulty. She was born with perfect vision, but as a child, there was a medical situation that they misdiagnosed, and she ended up being blind for the majority of her life. She wrote hundreds of songs, but one of those songs that I love is Blessed Assurance. The other one is Draw Me Near. I am thine, O Lord. I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. And I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. And then the chorus, draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. And there are other verses that are powerful. Draw us, Lord. If I want to endure, has anybody like me that realized that this life can be challenging? This life can just beat the snot out of you. You know? And we have to have a mindset and an understanding of endurance. Peter said, don't think it strange concerning the fiery trials that'll try you as though some strange things has happened. Jesus said, if they hated me, then they're going to hate you. Don't be surprised. And see, that's a mindset that we have to have, because are you like me that sometimes when things don't go well, I'm like, what happened? Oh my goodness. We have to recognize that if I was a contributor to going off the rails, then okay, fix it. But sometimes you're not a contributor, it just goes off the rails. And you have little control over that. But I want to tell you, the story is not over. And it's not going to be over until we pass through the veil into eternity on the other side. In Hebrews chapter 11, it's known as like the roll call of heroes of faith. People who, you know, it talks about Abraham, and it talks about Noah, it talks about Moses, it talks about Enoch. By faith Rahab, by faith, and on and on. It's a powerful chapter. But it says that they died not seeing the promise fulfilled. I mean, think about Abraham. The promise to Abraham is still going on right now. We are, and everybody that comes to Jesus until He comes back are a part of the story. My mom prays, and I am so thankful that she does. She prays for me. She prays for a lot of things. My dad passed away, went to be with Jesus a little over a year ago, and any of you that has lost a spouse, you know, it's like part of you is gone, and she really challenged, like any of us would be, but she's going to pray, and she said, you know what, I am praying. She prays for her family, she prays for other needs, and she says, even if I don't see it in my lifetime, I'm going to pray. That's the right attitude. Whether I see it in my lifetime or not. Was it Jacob that gave instruction about his bones when they left Egypt? Was that Jacob? Okay. I wasn't sure. I was pretty sure it started with a J. I mean, listen, what kind of faith is that? It's like, listen, dudes, we're captive in Egypt. But when I die and you bury me, when God delivers you from the Egyptians and takes you to the promised land, dig my bones up and take them with you. Now, what kind of faith is that? I've got to tell you, I get frustrated with myself because I'm so easily discouraged. I'm so easily, something didn't go right, you know? And if we aren't careful, we can be filled with pride, self-pity. Why is this happening to me? Nobody has it as bad as I do. And I feel like just grabbing myself by the collar and like, what's the matter with you? Because that is not only unproductive, but that invites a whole bunch of critters, and they're not good critters, to come and hang out with you. Because it's a lie. And it really has its essence in pride. Okay, got to move on. All right, so the first thing that we need to wrap our heads around, if we are going to be people of endurance, to finish the race, is we need to be those that draw near to God. The second thing is to hold fast. So let us hold fast. The Bible says, the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. We're holding fast our profession. My father-in-law used to say all the time, when you get to the end of your rope, tie a knot and hang on. Right? When you don't know what else to do, hold steady. Hang on. Hold steady. Hold fast. Don't give up. Don't veer to the right or to the left. Hold on. Hold fast. And what are we holding fast to? The confession of our hope. Now, words are powerful, aren't they? Words are extremely powerful. And the Bible says that death and life are in the power of the tongue. We need to realize that in Genesis chapter 1, the Bible says that the Spirit of God hovered over the emptiness. The Spirit of God was brooding over. So God was there, but nothing happened until God spoke. And what did God say? Let there be light. A billion shafts of light. And then we know that he created the sun and the moon and the stars and all of those things. But God, the creative power. We're holding fast the confession. In Hebrews chapter 2, it says, Jesus Christ, our high priest, he's the high priest of our confession. Why do you think in Romans it says, this is how you're saved? If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart we believe and with the mouth we confess. So I just want to encourage you, take care of the things that come out of our mouths. We want to speak blessing, not cursing. We want to speak life and not death. We want to speak hope and faith, not discouragement. Okay, and I'm not saying, be goofy about it. You know what I mean? So, let's say I break my arm. All right? I'm not talking about my arm's not broke, my arm's not broke, my arm's not broke. I'm not talking about denying reality when I'm talking about speaking life. I'm talking about a higher reality, and that is speaking life. God, heal my arm. It's not against the rules to say, yep, my arm's broken. But we can say, God, my arm's broken. Can you fix it? I prayed for a little girl one time. Her grandma brought her to the altar after the service. This was in Eastern Oregon a bunch of years ago. And she had broken her arm, and it was in a cast. And she'd been to the doctor, and the doctor said, the bones are not connecting. They're not healing up. And so she wanted to pray. So we anointed with oil, and we prayed. And I still have the note that this grandma wrote to me. And she said, we went back in, and they x-rayed, and they don't have to do anything. The bones are starting to mend fine. And she was fine. So God does answer prayer, and he does heal. But we don't have to deny the truth in order to see God at work. All right? Let us hold fast to our confession and our confession of hope. Hope. Hold fast to hope. Hopelessness is a real difficult thing. I was just talking with my wife, Janelle, just within the last couple of days, and we are seeing statistics about the effect of the isolation and the COVID years, I guess. Nobody knows what to call it, but mental illness, depression, suicide, all of those things, and they're attributing it to this isolation and this hopelessness, right? Don't you think the enemy wants us to lose hope? The enemy wants us, the Bible says that hope deferred makes the heart sick. In other words, delays. When things are delayed that we're hoping for, that our expectation. Well, I just want to encourage you. You can be very tempted to become cynical and say, make up your own Bible. Blessed are those that have no expectations, for they shall not be disappointed. Okay, that's not in the Bible. In fact, that's just the opposite. Do you know what that's called? It's called cynicism. And being cynical is epidemic in our nation. And I'm reading a book on prayer, and there's a chapter on removing cynicism from your prayer life. And oh, is the Holy Spirit piercing my heart. Are any of you kind of lend yourself towards cynicism if you're not careful? I do. And that's not faith, and that's not hope. And now abideth these three, faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love. But faith and hope and love are so intertwined that you really cannot have one without the other. Faith knows it will happen. Hope says, maybe it's going to happen today. You see? See the difference? Hope is, I'm praying for my prodigal son to return home. I mean, faith says, I'm praying, but hope sees him when he's a long way off. Why did the prodigal son's father see the son when he was a long way off? Because he was looking for him. We see what we're looking for. Hold fast to hope without wavering. Don't let that cynicism begin to infiltrate into us. And why can we hold our confession of hope without wavering? Because he who promised is faithful. Oh, you can never say it enough. Great is thy faithfulness, O God. Faithful is he who called you, who will also perform it. Faithful. He is faithful. He is faithful. He's never going to leave us or forsake us. Even if I don't see it in my lifetime, God is faithful. Hallelujah, the joy of the Lord. All right, here we go. Let's recapitulate. That means to say what we've already said. Let us draw near. Everybody say draw near. Draw near to God. That's how we're going to endure. We got to draw near to God. Let us hold fast. Everybody say, hold fast. The confession of our faith without wavering. And the last one is this. Let us, and this one's interesting. Let us consider one another, how that we may consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. I had to remember what version I was reading here. Let us consider one another. Do you know what that means? That means we're supposed to think about each other. Consider, give some thought in a couple of specific areas. Think about how that we can stir up love, spur one another on to love and good works. Think about, how could I encourage Casey today? How could I encourage Al today? Is there anything that I could do to spur Anthony on, to hold steady, keep moving forward, to keep serving God, to keep, you know what I mean? In other words, think about, and probably, you guys have heard of the ripple effect? This probably starts in my own home. Think about how I can encourage those that are closest to me. Think about one another. Are you like me? Are you most of the time thinking about you? Thinking about myself, what I'm doing, where I'm going, what's next for me, blah, 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 right? Think about one another to stir up love and good works. Good works are important. We are not saved. Everybody say this. I am not saved by works. Okay, that's important. You know that, but I want to say that. However, works are important. That's not how we're saved, because we could never work hard enough, do enough good deeds. We can't earn it. Salvation is a free gift of God. It's the grace of God that brings salvation, right? But good works are important. Do you know why they're important? Because in the very last chapter of the last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 22, Jesus says, "Behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give to every man according to his," what? Works, deeds, same thing. Listen, that's not bad news. God's not looking to beat us up. That means God's given you an assignment. God's given you an assignment. And some of us, we're doing the assignment, but we don't even think it's God. And if you have any babies or grandbabies that are in the diaper stage where you're changing diapers at all right, so do you ever consider the fact that by caring for that child, you're serving the Lord? That during this season of your life, that's your assignment, to take care of that child. And actually, if you're a parent, there is no season where you get to not take care of that child. Because they leave, but then they come back. I did. I did. I left and came back. Oh, sorry, Mom. All right. Consider, let's think about one another. Think about, what about, okay, if the ripple effect, so it starts at home and then it begins to go out. What about people that you work with? Is there any way that you could think about them in order to encourage them toward love and good deeds? Now, you don't have to tell them that that's what you're doing. Just encourage them. And even if they're obnoxious and a pain where you can't locate, find something that you can encourage them about. Right? We can do that. I mean, even the most obnoxious people, and you, what will happen is, when we begin to speak life, we begin to speak hope, and we begin to think about other people and not ourselves, that quote that Pastor Anthony shared during offering, what a powerful thing to not be so self-absorbed that we don't consider one another. And then it takes the next step, not forsaking, not forgetting to assemble ourselves together, as some are in the habit of doing, but do it more. Get together, and that could be right here, our gathering. That could be a small group Bible study. That could be over a cup of coffee at a restaurant somewhere. Gathering, all it takes is two people to gather. Could be a small group, could be a large group, but do it. He said, endurance, this is going to be important, because in the last days, Trouble's coming, people. Jesus said that. The very first thing he said, in the last days, there's going to be trouble. Show, teacher, give us the sign of the end of all things, the end of days. What should we look for? And Jesus said, trouble is coming. But don't worry. Just hold steady. Draw near to God. Hold fast your confession of hope. And don't forget to be together. We need one another. If we didn't need one another, why would God say it's not good for man to be alone? Right? Adam had a perfect relationship with God, perfect provision. Everything was provided for him there in the garden. Perfect fellowship, communion, perfect environment. And God said, it's not good to be alone. And so God called a deep sleep to fall on Adam. And nobody's slept since. That was a joke. And God brought Eve alongside Adam, not under Adam's feet, and not over Adam's head. She was taken from side. And God is the Lord of us all. Okay. Last thing. And then we're going to have communion, and then we'll be done. We are all living in unfinished stories, all of us. Our stories are still being written. And we're going to see, some of us have already seen amazing story, God's stories unfold. Some of us are just beginning that journey of seeing God's stories unfold. Without endurance, we're going to miss, as Paul Harvey would say, some of you don't know who that is, the rest of the story. Yeah, Al does. The rest of the story. If we don't endure, if we don't see this thing through, we're going to miss where the underdog wins, where truth triumphs, where justice prevails, where evil is destroyed, where relationships are healed, where true love wins. We're going to miss all that. And we're going to miss where they all live happily ever after. Yeah. Somebody said, yeah, Disney, that's a happily ever after. I'd like, you know what I mean? There's that cynicism again. But you know what? Jesus ain't Disney. I know that's not proper grammar. God's not the Wizard of Oz. He's the holy God of the universe. And he's invited us to draw near. And he has given us a high priest in Jesus Christ so that we can come boldly before him and hold fast to our confession. And he's given us one of the most precious gifts that sometimes we overlook, and that's one another. We need one another. The enemy will do anything he can to divide. But God joins, brings together. Okay, so let's recapitulate, shall we? One last time, then we're going to share communion. Let us draw near to God. Let us hold fast our confession of faith and hope. And let us consider one another to encourage one another toward love and good works. And do it more as the day of Christ's return comes closer. Don't know when that's going to be, but it's closer now than when we first believed. Amen. So did you all receive the communion emblems? Okay. So if you could get those ready and go ahead and we're going to listen to a song. It has the lyrics on the screen. This particular song was very paramount in the Welsh Revival in the early 1900s, 1904, 1905. This was a song that came out of that era. And a couple of the verses are sung in Welsh, the Welsh language, and so unless you speak Welsh, you're not going to understand it, but just hold steady because then the lyrics will show in English as well, and they sing it in English, all right? And this is a hymn, and it's called Here Is Love, and we're going to watch this, and then we're going to share communion together.
Through our tears, please turn on me.
take our communion emblems, if you would, and peel back to grab the bread there. This we do in remembrance of the Lord. This we do to draw near, to hold fast, and to consider the assignment of encouragement that God has given to us. It's all because of Him. So we remember, Jesus said, as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. So let's take the bread and let's give thanks right now. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for the bread of life, Jesus. We thank you that you willingly laid down your life for us so that we might be partakers of eternal life in you. In Jesus' name, let's partake together. And then the cup. Let's thank the Lord for his precious blood. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for the pathway that you have invited us. We can't even believe it sometimes, that you have invited us to be partakers of the eternal kingdom. You are our hope, our strength. You are our song. You are our great reward. Jesus, we love you. We thank you. We remember you. We honor you. And Lord, as we partake today, the body and the blood, Lord, would you infuse us with a spirit of endurance that comes from your Holy Spirit. That we will not draw back, we will not quit, we will not give up, but we will press in. Thank you, Lord, for your grace upon us. Let's partake of the cup together. Could we stand together, please? As we stand, I would like our prayer team, those that are here and available, if you could come forward. We're going to pray a closing prayer, and then I want to invite, if you would like someone to pray with you, if you have a need, we would love to have the opportunity to do that together and pray and share together. But if we could just bow our heads, close our eyes. I just have two questions. No one looking around, please. First is this: if you are here today and you have never received Christ, you have not confessed that Jesus is Lord, you have not received him into your life, ask him to cleanse your sin, become a new person. Or if you've done that in the past, but you know that right now you are not in fellowship with the Lord. Either one of those, you never have or you have, but you're not walking with the Lord right now. And you know it. And you'd say, I'm coming to Jesus. I want to draw near to God. Just lift up your hand. I want to include you as we pray. Is there anybody? Say, I need to come to Jesus, or I need to renew that relationship with the Lord. Anyone looking across? This might be your moment. Thanks, man. I appreciate that. Anybody else? This could be the time. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. Anyone else? Everything can change, but it takes that first step. Anyone else? Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. And then secondly, I want to ask this. If you sensed through God's word and the prompting of the Holy Spirit that God is speaking to you about drawing near, say, you know what? I've allowed maybe distractions or hindrances to keep me from drawing near to the Lord. I want a plan as we're moving into 2023 to use this year to draw near to the Lord. I want to look back and say I'm closer to Jesus at the end than I was at the beginning of the year. Should the Lord tarry? Should we even have the full year? Or if the Holy Spirit is talking to you about holding fast, not getting bumped off target, or using you to be an encourager. If the Lord has spoken to you through this message, I want you to lift up your hand because I want to pray for you. Say, yeah, the Lord's talking to me about drawing near or about holding fast or about considering those around me. God's talking to me about considering those around me. Okay, hands going up everywhere. My hands are up too. I need all three of these to come alive in my heart in a new and a living way. Let's pray together. So Heavenly Father, God, I want to thank you for the faith and the expression. God, you know everything about us and you love us completely and unconditionally. Father, and I thank you for those hands that were raised that I need to receive Christ and or I need to renew that relationship with him. And God, I just speak your blessing over every hand that was raised, every commitment to press in, to draw near to God, to hold fast the confession that we have in Christ and hold on to faith and hope and to consider those around us. I pray that you would give them grace and mercy in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, I trust that the Lord has encouraged you and that you've been strengthened through the Word of God today. And I am so grateful that we can walk this journey together with the Lord and with one another, and that His presence is with us, that we can, with endurance, run the race that He's called us to, finish the assignment that He has for every one of our lives. We would encourage you, if you don't have a church home, we'd love to have you join us at either one of our campuses. Mycrossfire.com is the website you can go to find out information about what's happening. You can also call the church at 541-686-3473, 686-LIFE, L-I-F-E. And we would love to hear from you and have the opportunity to meet you. So God bless you and thank you again for joining us today.
Welcome everyone. We are so glad that you have gathered today and we are not with you, as most of you know. Yes, we do. We are actually standing in Israel. We are at a place called Gideon Spring and we hope that today's worship service is amazing.
Yeah.
If you want to follow us on our Facebook account, the church's or mine, we've detailed this trip event by event by event, hoping that if those that were interested wanted to share, they could know what's happening on this whole trip. I just want to say to you today that this trip has been like my first different, because I was able to be with my wife. We're very thankful for the group who sent us. We're here with many pastors from New York and
Pennsylvania,
yeah,
Arizona,
California, Washington. Yeah. They're just all over. And they've been gathered together. Certain ones were asked. And it was really those who were willing to stand for liberty, freedom, and their faith.
Yeah.
And they saw our church as a church that was willing to do that. And you as a people were willing to do that, and as a pastor, we were willing to also stand. We have to stand for our faith in this time. And Israel, the very string in which we're standing at right now, this is where Gideon gathered his army, brought them down to this stream.
And God began to narrow the troops.
Yeah. And Christy likes to share this, so I'll let her share it real quick, although we're getting over time. Go ahead.
I love this area of scripture because, you know, the enemy even knows that God wins. And so, you know, it's just such a victor story of God showing off and showing up and doing what only he can. And, you know, so in our lives when we feel like we're the weak ones or we feel like that we're the underdog, know that if we follow the Lord, he'll direct our path and our steps. And we won't be victorious. It's not about us being victorious. It's about God's being victorious in us. And ultimately, we want to raise him up. We want to give him all the glory. And so it's exciting.
Yes. Tell the part about how that he asked him to bring his servant if he was afraid.
You know, I love that God gets us. I love that God gets when we're even afraid. And, you know, one of my favorite parts of that story is when God tells Gideon to go spy out the land. And he says, go spy out the land. And if you're afraid, bring your servant with you. And the very next verse says, Gideon and his servant went down. You know, so God gets the fears we have. God gets the insecurities we have. But, you know, God proved to Gideon even in that moment that even the enemy knows we win. And so follow him. Do what the Lord says. Follow the direction of God and we win.
And if you're afraid,
trust the Lord. Even if you're afraid, yeah.
If you're afraid, put your head up, move forward.
Yeah.
Some of you know, coming on this trip, the enemy tried so hard to stop us. Mm-hmm. And even as we literally took off, my doctor called and said, don't fly, it's dangerous, because they're afraid I have a blood clot in my lung, and I'm not crying out of fear. I'm telling you, I watched the enemy try so hard to stop us from accomplishing and doing what God has called us to do. And don't let him in your life.
God,
don't let him stop you.
The victor.
That's right. Yeah. I'm here. My lungs are a little compromised, but we know who is the author of fear and who is the author of wisdom. Mm-hmm. And we are here because of the call of God. We want to gain and grow and bring back many things. We're already filled up. Mm-hmm. We're only halfway done.
Yeah.
But we'll be back at the end of this week. And I just want to tell you that
God's doing good stuff.
God's doing great stuff.
Yeah.
And we've been blessed already by the people. Today we had a chance to go see a big area that was amazing, where actually Saul and Jonathan's heads were hung in the city square. But I say that to say that as we were there, we were walking out, and there was a couple that were on a tour, and they were pastors in St. Louis. They're not on our tour, on a different one. And as I was talking to them, I thought, oh, I may have missed part of this little tour for a few minutes. And I thought, what's more important than all of the things we see? Mm-hmm. It's the people.
The application of it in our lives and in people's lives.
And I'm thankful to grow and learn through all this.
Yeah.
But it is the people in our lives that matter. And you matter. We thank you, all of you.
Yeah.
Hope you have a great church service. We hope to see you this week. And thank you for all your care and your love.
Yeah.
Bye.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today and make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon, 97477, 541-686-3473, or find us on the web at mycrossfire.com.